This is another video on the Victorian novelists. I have already posted a video on Charles Dickens and his novels. Now, I have also posted videos on the Bronte sisters and their novels. Today, this video is on Thackeray, George Eliot, and a few others. You're looking at William Makepeace Thackeray. Thackeray was born in 1811. Actually, he was born 1 year before. Before whom? Before Charles Dickens. Charles Dickens was born in 1812. And he died in 1863. Now, do you know where Thackeray was born? Thackeray was born in a place that we know. He was born in Calcutta. Thackeray was born in Calcutta of Anglo-Indian parents. And he came to England in 1817. That was the year in which, Biographia Literaria was published. And he was educated at private schools. Later, he went to Charterhouse Boarding School. And he did not like the school very much. He did not like institutionalized education even very much. And he called it Slaughterhouse or Greyfriars in his fiction. He was never too keen on academic education. And he did not complete his studies at Trinity College, Cambridge, or at Middle Temple, where he studied law. That also he did not complete. And he went to Paris to study study art. That also he did not accomplish. He squandered much of his wealth also. People must have thought, what a useless fellow. But little did they know that he is going to be William Makepeace Thackeray. Now, he squandered much of his wealth by gambling and lost some of it in some unsuccessful ventures. He visited Paris in 1829 and he had a lifelong love of the city. Now, he traveled to Germany also, where he met Goethe. Many people in the Victorian period were influenced by Germany and Germans. In 1836, that was the year in which Charles Dickens started publication. He published his Pickwick Papers in that year serially. He published his first book, Lithograph Caricatures. It was not a novel. Flor et Zephyr. Not very important for us. The same year, he married the mentally unstable Isabella Shaw, who went completely insane later. Thackeray returned to London in 1837, where his daughter Anne was born. Later, she attained some fame as the novelist Anne Thackeray Ritchie. In 1840, Harriet Marian was born. Harriet Marian was the future wife of Leslie Stephen. Do you know who is Leslie Stephen? The father of Virginia Woolf. So Virginia Woolf that way becomes his granddaughter, Thackeray's granddaughter. Thackeray contributed to a lot of magazines for a living. He wrote reviews, comic sketches, parodies, satires. Notably, he contributed to Fraser's Magazine and Punch. They are two famous magazines. For Fraser's, he wrote the Yellow Plush Papers, the comic memoirs of a footman. The Yellow Plush Papers appeared as the comic memoirs of a footman. Catherine was an early novel that he wrote. Catherine is a pastiche of the popular Newgate fiction. It is a Newgate novel, and it's a pastiche of popular Newgate novels. And he took pseudonyms, Charles James Yellow Plush. It is under that name that he wrote the Yellow Plush Papers. He wrote under the name Charles James Yellow Plush, Michelangelo Titmarsh. He called himself Michelangelo Titmarsh because he was a good artist like Michelangelo. And George Savage Fitzboodle. This man, this is a pseudonym, and this persona was a heavy tobacco addicted club man. He pretended that he's a heavy tobacco addicted club man. That is the persona of George Savage Fitzboodle. These are all pseudonyms that he used. Are you following? The autobiographical Fitzboodle Papers appeared under this name of George Savage Fitzboodle. Charles James Yellow Plush, Michelangelo Titmarsh, George Savage Fitzboodle. And George Savage Fitzboodle was also presented as the editor of Thackeray's first real novel, Barry Lyndon. Catherine was not a real novel. It was a pastiche of popular Newgate fiction. And Barry Lyndon was the first real novel that he wrote. It was serially published in Fraser's magazine. Fraser's and Punch were the two magazines he contributed to, remember. In this period, he also wrote three travel books. The Paris Sketchbook, the Irish Sketchbook, Notes of a Journey from Cornhill to Grand Cairo. These are the travel books that he wrote. The Paris Sketchbook, the Irish Sketchbook, and Notes of a Journey from Cornhill to Grand Cairo. And he had growing reputation in 1840s. His fame was increasing. And two major works came at this time. One was Book of Snobs. It was actually a collection of his writings for Punch. And his first major novel was Vanity Fair, 1847. Now, 1847 is also the year in which Jane Eyre and Wuthering Heights were published. Jane Eyre and Wuthering Heights are both videos in Udemy course, NET English complete course. Until recently, I had also put the preview of these. Wuthering Heights is also there. Both are there in YouTube also. Please watch. The first major novel is Vanity Fair. The first proper novel by Thackeray is Barry Lyndon. And the first novel that he wrote is Catherine. And Vanity Fair, which we'll deal with in greater detail, is a satirical anti-heroic novel. It satirized the class consciousness of early Victorian age. Satirical anti-heroic novel satirized the class consciousness of early Victorian age. And he was discontent with contemporary fictional stereotypes at this time. He did not emulate the contemporary stereotypes in fiction. Vanity Fair is subtitled A Novel Without a Hero, 1847-48. The title is taken from Pilgrim's Progress, where a never-ending fair in Pilgrim's Progress, there is the city of or the town of Vanity, where a never-ending fair is happening. And it represents man's sinful attachment to worldly things. Here in Vanity Fair also, same thing. Like in Madame Bovary, etc. It's a naturalist novel where with naturalist elements, that is. Where the protagonist, Becky Sharp, is because of societal peculiarities, you know, women were not allowed to have any ambition. They did not get proper education. They did not have employment opportunities. Now, Becky Sharp's only way to become rich and powerful is by getting some rich and powerful men. She married a man like that, but he turned out to be good for nothing. So, this leads her into a lot of immorality, Becky Sharp. And her attachment to worldly things leads to her downfall. So Pilgrim's Progress is also on a similar theme. I mean, Vanity Fair is on a similar... The fair of Vanity happening in Pilgrim's Progress is also symbolizing a similar thing. Becky and Amelia are the two characters, central characters in Vanity Fair. Becky Sharp or Rebecca Sharp and Amelia Sedley. At the beginning of the novel, you see they have completed their studies. It is not in Harvard or Oxford or any big university. They have studied at Miss Pinkerton's Academy for Young Ladies. Young ladies were not given any proper education. They got only like domestic education or education about making bed and cooking and, you know, domestic chores, how to do domestic chores, that kind of education. And after completing their studies here, they have come to Amelia's house at Russell Square. And Amelia is a very good-natured, lovable, passive and naive, very feminine girl. Her femininity is also turning out to be a mockery. At the end, even though she is appearing perfect, that kind of perfect femininity is also made fun of. She is betrothed to the dashing, self-obsessed Captain George Osborne. That is the male, one of the men, male protagonist. Amelia is betrothed to Captain George Osborne. And Becky Sharp is the anti-heroine, actually. She is Amelia's opposite. She is after some rich man so that she will get security in life. She is intelligent and talented and strong-willed and cunning. Sorry. Becky is introduced to Captain George Osborne and also to Amelia's brother, Joseph Sedley. He's a boastful, rich civil servant from the East India Company. So there is a subtle mockery of East India Company and the colonizers also. Joseph Sedley is interested in Becky. He wants, Becky wants Sedley to marry her. And Joseph Sedley is also like gullible. But Osborne, who is interested in Becky, foils the plan. Becky leaves Amelia's house, Russell Square, to work as a governess to Sir Pitt Crawley's daughters. One aristocrat, Sir Pitt Crawley, has daughters and also sons. And Becky leaves to become a governess there. Sir Crawley, after some time, proposes to Becky. But by then, she is secretly married to Sir Pitt Crawley's son, Rawdon Crawley. She seduced him and managed to marry him. Now, Captain Rawdon Crawley is disinherited by Sir Pitt Crawley's affluent half-sister, Miss Crawley. Even though Becky manages to marry a rich man, he becomes poor. And the estate, Crawley estate, goes to Rawdon's elder brother. That means Becky's husband's elder brother, who is also called Pitt Crawley. Amelia's father, John Sedley, at this time becomes bankrupt at Russell Square. Amelia's father becomes bankrupt. Amelia is now poor. And Captain George Osborne's father forbids George from marrying Amelia because George Osborne's father does not want his son to marry a pauper's daughter. But George Osborne marries Amelia against his father's will and is pressurized by his friend William Dobbin to do this. That is why. And then George is also disinherited. So both girls are now married to men who are disinherited. Now George encounters Becky and Captain Rawdon Crawley at Brighton. George Osborne encounters Betty and her husband at Brighton, where George and Becky flirt. George even writes a letter to her asking her to run away with him. But Becky doesn't do that. George is married to Amelia and they flirt, but Becky doesn't run away with George. Amelia comes to know that something is happening between her husband and Becky. She already knows that Becky is flirtatious and Amelia is hurt. And there develops a rift between the two women. Amelia at this time is completely in love with George Osborne and she cannot imagine that George Osborne can cheat her. She is very feminine and devoted to her husband and she doesn't suspect her own husband. She's too foolish and feminine. Meanwhile, the Napoleonic Wars are taking place. Osborne and Crawley and Dobbin, all the men, Osborne, Crawley, Dobbin, they all go to Waterloo to fight in the Napoleonic Wars, the last battle in which Napoleon is defeated. Captain Crawley survives, but George dies in the battle. Captain Rawdon Crawley survives. That is, Becky's husband survives, but Amelia's husband dies. Joseph Sedley has fled from the battle. The brother of Amelia was also there, Joseph Sedley. He escapes from the battle, but boasts about his valor as if he fought in the war bravely. He boasts. That is a lie. He did not fight. He actually fled from the war. Amelia and Becky were at this time carrying, pregnant, and they both give birth to sons. And their sons are named after their fathers. While Amelia is devastated by her husband's death and dotes on her son, young Rawdon Crawley, Becky enters the vain high society in London. She is now moving in the high society in London. She is meeting up with rich men and doing them favors and making money out of it. Her flirtations extort money from admirers, while Captain Crawley drinks and gambles heavily. Her husband uses this money, drinks and gambles heavily. The couple obtain credit by tricking everyone into believing that they are receiving money from others. This is like a scam. They make money. At the summit of her success, Becky's relationship with the rich and powerful Marquis of Steyne is discovered. She is very successful at the height of her success. Becky's relationship with a powerful Marquis, a nobleman, is discovered. And Rawdon is also arrested for debt. Their money and their high society life, everything comes to an end. Rawdon's brother's wife, Lady Jane, bails him out. Rawdon's brother's wife is Lady Jane. Remember Rawdon's brother, younger Pitt Crawley, who got the estate. His wife, Lady Jane, bails him out. Now, sorry. What did I do? What happens is Rawdon leaves Becky. Rawdon, when Becky's bad life is brought to light and Rawdon is arrested, he leaves Becky after he's released, of course, and later dies of yellow fever. Typhus or yellow fever was very common in Victorian England. Becky, who is now put under shame, put to shame, she leaves the country and wanders the continent. But wherever she goes, her disreputable history follows her. Everybody knows her story. And her bad name follows her. Now, their sons are older. Becky's son and Amelia's son are older. And William Dobbin, the friend of George Osborne, remember? William Dobbin professes his unchanged love to Amelia. He always loved her. But Amelia could not think of anybody but her own husband, even after his death. So she kept refusing William Dobbin's proposal. Amelia's father-in-law, that is George Osborne's father, bequeaths Amelia's son with a large fortune. At that time, he was angry, remember. He had disinherited George, his son, that is Amelia's husband. Now, he gives money to Amelia's son. Amelia's son is named after his father, that is George Osborne is the name. And Amelia also gets a generous annual income. Amelia and Joseph. Joseph is Amelia's brother, remember. George, that is the son. William Dobbin. All go on a trip to Germany. Remember, Thackeray also had gone to Germany. And he writes that these characters are also going to Germany. And there they meet the destitute Becky. Becky was traveling from country to country. Wherever she went, her disreputable history followed her. Somebody will be there who knows her and her history. And they meet Becky here. She's destitute, poor. Becky resumes her seduction of Joseph Sedley. She is still not changed. She still tries to make money by seduction. Joseph later dies after signing a portion of his money to Becky. They do not get married. Amelia reconciles with Becky. Amelia makes up with Becky. Remember, they were not talking after Becky and Joseph flirted. And Amelia feels sorry for Becky when she hears that Becky's ties with her son have been severed. Becky's son hates Becky because of Becky's bad reputation. And Amelia feels sorry for Becky. After all, they were friends. Becky then shows Amelia the note that George Osborne had written to her, asking Becky to run away with him. Amelia stops idealizing him and marries Dobbin. Amelia, till now, was idealizing her husband, George Osborne. Amelia now stops idealizing him and marries William Dobbin, who always loved her. Becky's son, Rawdon Crawley, young Rawdon, becomes a baronet at this time. He gets money and a title. And he supports Becky financially, but declines any further relationship with her. He will not accept her as his mother because of the immorality. So Becky is immoral and she's punished for it. But you should understand that it was not her fault entirely. It was because of the unequal relations of sexes and genders in Victorian society. Captain George Osborne is also flirting, but he gets away with it. A woman can never get away with it. Did you understand? The opportunities for women are also very different. In fact, women have no opportunities. So in such a society, it is no wonder that some women will turn out to be Becky Sharps. So that is Vanity Fair. The ending, opening of Vanity Fair, etc. They have asked questions. Please read a little bit on your own. Research on your own. Now, two more novels by Thackeray. Vanity Fair was an immediate popular and critical success. People liked Vanity Fair as soon as it was published. It was followed by The History of Pendennis. The History of Pendennis, 1848 to 50. 1848, year of Pre-Raphaelite Brotherhood formation. Communist Manifesto was written in 1848. The History of Pendennis, Vanity Fair. After Vanity Fair came, The History of Pendennis. It's semi-autobiographical, Bildungsroman. Please read more about it. They might ask some questions in the exams. And it says, it portrays one of the gentlemen of our age. What are Victorian men like? What is gentlemanly culture in the Victorian period? That is what the novel is about. In 1848, Thackeray had an unfulfilled affair with the wife of a college friend, Jane Brookfield. And the melancholy of love, unfulfilled, enters the next novel, The History of Henry Esmond. The History of Henry Esmond is based on his own unfulfilled love affair. 1852. Now, the most carefully planned of his novels, this was. The History of Henry Esmond was the most carefully planned of his novels. The only one to be published originally in the three-volume format. All the other novels that I talked about were serially published. Remember, in the Victorian period, the three-volume format was very popular. And originally published in three volumes, that is Henry Esmond. So always study the chronology of the novels also thoroughly. Catherine, Barry Lyndon, Vanity Fair, Pendennis, Henry Esmond. It's a historical novel. Henry Esmond is a historical novel set during the reign of Queen Anne. Students of Tess, I hope you are looking at the encyclopedia along with the video, because there are many extra points in the encyclopedia. After a lecture tour of the United States, he produced more novels. The Newcomes came in 1853-55. Please study the chronology once again. The Newcomes, after that came The Virginians. The Newcomes is a panoramic novel of English social life during the first half of the 19th century. The Newcomes is a panoramic English novel of English social life. Panoramic means showing a lot of aspects of social life. The Rose and the Ring is one of his Christmas books. Remember, Charles Dickens also wrote Christmas books. Thackeray also wrote 6 Christmas books. The Rose and the Ring is the last and the best of his Christmas books. I did not mention all his Christmas books here, obviously. I have mentioned only the last and the best. And then he made a second visit to the United States. Remember, Charles Dickens also visited the United States. And Charles Dickens' two novels have references to Americans. Martin Chuzzlewit and American Notes. Did you look it up? Did you read extra about it? You have to read, okay. Now coming back to Thackeray. He lectured on the four Georges while he was traveling in the United States. He lectured on the four Georges. The Virginians was another novel. And it is a historical novel. Henry Esmond was also a historical novel. They're all related novels. The Newcomes is followed by The Virginians, its sequel. It continues the Henry Esmond saga. Esmond family saga. I told you they're all related novels. They all have the same story. I mean, same people's story. Please do some extra reading on your own. Then, after a lecture tour of the United States, he produced more novels. He did a lecture tour of the United States, I told you. After Virginians, he did not do another lecture tour. In 1859, Thackeray became the founding editor of the Cornhill magazine. The Cornhill magazine was founded by Thackeray and edited by Thackeray. Founding editor. He was the founder and the editor. Thackeray founded the Cornhill magazine. It's a monthly literary journal. Please make a list of major literary journals. I had given this assignment in some previous video. And also their periodicity, whether it's monthly or quarterly or weekly, etc. The last works of Thackeray were published in Cornhill magazine. These include Lovell, The Widower, and the essays gathered in roundabout papers. Thackeray wrote a lot of essays, remember? Charles James, Yellow Plush, Michelangelo, Titmarsh, George Savage, Fitzboodle. These are all his pseudonyms. And the Roundabout Papers is a collection of essays. The last completed novel of Thackeray is The Adventures of Philip. It is actually a repetition of the themes of Pendennis and Newcomes. Nothing new there. And he left an unfinished novel when he died. The novel is Denis Duval. He died on Christmas Eve in 1863. He was born in 1811, remember. So he died leaving Denis Duval unfinished. Thackeray is a central figure in Victorian realism, like George Eliot. George Eliot and Thackeray, Victorian realists. Charles Dickens, also realist, but of a different sort. Thackeray is skeptical and ironic, but he also had a compassionate vision of human conduct in a society dominated by the power of money and class. Wrote satirical, ironic kind of language, kind of novels, but also had a compassionate vision of human conduct. Thackeray is indebted to Fielding. Like Henry Fielding, Thackeray also did not create heroes and villains. He did not write in a very sentimental style. Fielding was against the sentimental style of Samuel Richardson, remember. Thackeray was unsentimental, unlike Dickens. And Thackeray used satire instead. Early in his career, he was neglected. People did not read him very much and critics did not pay attention to his works very much. His genius blossomed slowly, like Fielding's. Thackeray reacted against the popular novel of the day, especially against the romanticizing of rogues. He reacted against the novel traditions of the day. Many people wrote at this time romanticizing crime and rogues. Thackeray wrote Catherine as an anti-Newgate novel. He adopted Fielding's method instead and viewed his characters steadily and fearlessly. Even if his characters had bad qualities, vices, he depicted it fearlessly like Fielding. He did not whitewash his characters and justify his characters. He viewed his characters steadily and fearlessly. And he recorded his failures as well as merits. Not his, there. He recorded the failures as well as merits of his characters. His characters are rounded, but there is no flattery. He does not whitewash them, like I said. His clever people are sometimes rogues and virtuous people are fools. He did not show clever people as out and out clever and virtuous people as always good. He mixed some negativity into them. And his humor and pathos was also unlike Dickens's. Dickens's novels had the features of popular fiction. Dickens wrote melodramatic pathos, boisterous humor, but Thackeray's is more of sneering cynicism and satire. That is how he used humor. And his pathos is not melodramatic, it's quiet and effective and not sentimental at all. Thackeray's pathos is not sentimental. But remember, when I talked about Dickens, I told you that Dickens's pathos was sometimes painfully melodramatic, like in the case of Death of Children, the horrible death of Bill Sykes, etc. So that's about Thackeray. Now we have to talk about George Eliot. George Eliot was born in 1819, died in 1880. So she was younger than Thackeray and Dickens. And the Bronte, Charlotte Bronte also, at about the same time. The Brontes actually also came at this time. George Eliot, as everybody knows, was the pseudonym of Mary Ann Evans. She was born in Warwickshire. I have traveled across British countryside quite a lot. The countryside of Warwickshire is very different from the countryside of Yorkshire. Or Ireland or other parts. Warwickshire is more social. There are more people and lots of elements of the novels are actually based so much on that region. You can see George Eliot's novels actually coming alive there. Yorkshire is very different. Another important countryside in literature is, of course, Dorchester, Hardy. So Warwickshire is brought alive in George Eliot's novels. Because of YouTube, you can see all these things for yourself. Look it up in the internet. Read about it. Look it up in the internet. Transport yourself to that place, to that time. Use the internet productively. To learn, to experience. So George Eliot, after attending several schools, lived with her father at Foul's Hill near Coventry. And she was drawn to an intellectual circle there. Mary Ann Evans was friends with a lot of intellectuals, including Charles Bray. Many of these characters from her life appear in her fiction. And he directed her towards free thinking in religion. Mary Ann Evans, inspired by her friend Charles, questioned religion. She didn't go to church. She was a free thinker. Free thinkers were there in Victorian England at this time. In January 1842, she refused to attend church with her father. In those days, it was a big deal. Later, she completed the translation of a book called The Life of Jesus, critically examined by Dr. David Strauss. And it was published by John Chapman. That was a religious engagement that she did. She questioned religion through her translation as well. There followed a trip in the continent with the Brays. With her friend Charles Bray and his family, she traveled in the continent. She went to London from Warwickshire And she was closely associated with an amorous man there called Chapman. He was the publisher of the radical Westminster Review, where George Eliot became assistant editor from 1852 to 54. For her services, George Eliot received no salary but boarding and lodging. And Chapman conducted a boarding house where she lived, and it was frequented by middle-class intellectuals. Another important work of this time by George Eliot was the translation of Feuerbach's Essence of Christianity. These are all very important figures at that time, Feuerbach. Because of these, she began not only to question Christianity, but also she got interested in science and evolution, social Darwinism. Darwin's Origin of Species was only coming later, but the theory of evolution was already there. Darwin was influenced by other geologians like Charles Lyell, and the theory of evolution was already there, proposed by other people, even though it was proven by Darwin. So she was engaged in all such intellectual activities, and at this time she met George Henry Lewes, and he became her lifelong companion. They had a live-in relationship. They didn't get married, but she lived with him from this time until his death in 1878. I've gone to George Eliot Museum, where the chairs they sat in and talked to one another. Everything in that house is preserved there in Warwickshire. George Eliot's museum, yes. George Eliot's interest in writing fiction goes back to her school days. Now we'll talk about her works. She began writing stories in her school days. In 1857, three stories that she wrote were serially published in Blackwood's Edinburgh magazine. The Sad Fortunes of the Reverend Amos Barton, Mr. Gilfil's Love Story, and Janet's Repentance. You will wonder why I'm telling you the names of these early short stories that were published. Because these three short stories were collected and published as her first major work. Scenes of Clerical Life was a collection of these three stories. The Sad Fortunes of the Reverend Amos Barton, Mr. Gilfil's Love Story, and Janet's Repentance. This was followed by other books like Adam Bede. That is her first proper novel. The Mill on the Floss, Silas Marner. These are her rustic novels. Later novels that she wrote are philosophical and social. Let us first talk about Mill on the Floss, 1860. At Dalcourt Mill in St. Ogg's, that is where the story is set, there is Maggie Tulliver, a heroine. She lives with her parents and her brother. She is an unusually active and intelligent child and a tomboyish child. Her mother despairs with her. Her mother is fed up because she will not comb her hair and act like a lady. One day when she was scolded for not combing her hair, she even went upstairs and cut off all her hair. Maggie is emotionally dependent on her elder brother Tom, who calls her Magsie. Now, this is autobiographical. George Eliot was very emotionally dependent on her brother. But like it happens in Mill on the Floss, George Eliot's brother also did not support her very much. Now, Mr. Tulliver, their father, has married Mrs. Tulliver, who is from a wealthier family, and she has wealthy sisters. Mr. Tulliver has borrowed some money from one of Mrs. Tulliver's sisters, Mrs. Glegg. And Mr. Tulliver is poor, and he has a poor sister. Mr. Tulliver is also having a lawsuit with one lawyer, Wackham. And in the middle of the novel, we see that he loses that lawsuit also. Before that, he sends Tom, the son, to study under Mr. Stelling because he wants Tom to get education and make some money. And he sends Tom to study with Mr. Stelling. For this, he borrows money from Mrs. Glegg, one of the snobbish sisters of his wife. Now, he does not ask his own poor sister to repay him the money that he had lent her. They are poor, his own sister and her husband. And he does not ask them to return the money. He's a good man. That is what it means. Tom studies with Mr. Sterling. And there, Philip Wackham, the son of Lawyer Wackham, is his classmate. Maggie visits Tom and meets Philip. Philip is a hunchbacked boy. He's very sensitive. And Maggie feels sorry for Philip and slowly falls in love with him. Maggie is also sent to a school but called back when Mr. Tulliver lost the lawsuit. Tom is also brought back. Maggie is not sent to a school, is she? I think Tom is called back. I should change it like that. Maggie is not sent. Tom is called back. Okay, I've corrected it. When Mr. Tulliver lost the lawsuit with Lawyer Wackham over the use of the river floss, the lawsuit was. And Mr. Tulliver is made a manager in his own farm that he owned. Lawyer Wackham gets Dalcott Mill, and Mr. Tulliver is insulted and humiliated by being made a manager there. At that time, Bob Jackin, a childhood friend, re-enters Tom's and Maggie's life. He gives Maggie a book, The Imitation of Christ. And Maggie is inspired by this book, probably like our Charles Bray. And Bob Jackin influences Maggie. And Maggie starts a dull life of self-denial. She's brought back to normal life of literature and human interaction when she secretly meets Philip Wackham again and falls in love with him. Now her father is enemy of Lawyer Wackham. So Tom forbids Maggie from meeting Philip, but she likes Philip because she believes that Philip is innocent. Mr. Tulliver once attacks Lawyer Wackham and he has a stroke. Tulliver gets a stroke. He cannot walk properly or talk properly and dies soon afterwards. The whole family is affected by Mr. Tulliver's death. They don't know how to make money to live. So the family is separated. Mrs. Tulliver has to go and live with one of her sisters, Mrs. Dean, Mrs. Dean has a daughter, Lucy. She is very pretty and feminine, unlike our Maggie. And Maggie goes away and becomes a schoolmistress. Tom also is separated. Years later, Maggie, who has been a school teacher, returns to St. Ogg's to visit Lucy, her cousin, with whom Mrs. Tulliver now lives. Lucy Dean, Mrs. Dean, Mrs. Dean's daughter is Lucy, and Mrs. Tulliver is living with them. Lucy has a rich suitor, Stephen Guest. Mrs. Dean's husband, Mr. Dean, works with Stephen Guest's father. They are very rich people. And Stephen Guest is a friend of Philip. And Maggie and Stephen meet. Stephen gets attracted to Maggie. Even though Lucy is prettier, Stephen likes Maggie's independent spirit. A lot of Victorian novels show men being attracted to intelligent, independent women. Maggie does not reciprocate Stephen's love. She wants to leave St. Ogg's and Stephen. But before she leaves, they decide to go on a rowing trip. Philip, Lucy, Stephen, Maggie, they all decide to go on a rowing trip. But unfortunately, that day, Stephen falls ill. He's also jealous. And Maggie and Lucy are supposed to go. But then Lucy also cannot come, and Maggie is inadvertently alone with Stephen in the boat. Stephen and Maggie are alone in the boat. They go rowing, and they row too far. The weather changes. Stephen persuades her to row, to get on a larger boat, because now a storm is approaching. They cannot go back. So Stephen persuades Maggie to get on a larger boat that is going to the next town called Mudport. There, he says, they will get a boat to go back home. But on the way in the boat, he suggests to Maggie that they should go and get married there. He wants to marry Maggie. At first, Maggie is unable to resist, and she sleeps on the boat. Stephen watches over her. They have no physical relationship. The next day, she realizes the folly of what she is doing. She does not want to do this with Stephen, so she goes back home. She leaves Stephen and goes home. Stephen does not return. He instead goes to Holland. Back in St. Ogg's, everyone treats Maggie as a fallen woman because she spent the night with Stephen. Stephen by then had left for Holland. Tom is very angry with Maggie, refuses to take her into the house. And instead, she stays with Bob Jankin and his wife, Jankin. She's devastated. She's very unhappy because Tom doesn't trust her. But later on, she's reunited with Lucy and Philip. Lucy and Philip forgive her. And then the Floss floods. Floss is a river. It floods. Everybody is in danger. And Maggie rows a boat. She is tomboyish, remember? And she comes to rescue Tom, her brother. They make up. Tom is in the boat. Together, they go to rescue Lucy. But their boat capsizes. And they die in an embrace. Later, their body is found held in an embrace. And they were buried together. On their tomb was written the biblical line, "In their death, they were not divided." So Mill on the Floss is the story of a fiercely independent Victorian woman who goes against the morality of the age. But that doesn't mean she is not virtuous. Adam Bede came in 1859, momentous year. It is set in the village of Hayslop. Adam is a local carpenter. Please read the opening lines of all these novels, at least the opening lines. He's a local carpenter, much admired for his integrity and intelligence. And he is in love with the village beauty, Hetty Sorrel, who, however, does not reciprocate his love. Hetty instead is attracted to a charming military officer, Arthur Donnithorne. He is the local squire's son, grandson, that is. Hetty is attracted to Arthur Donnithorne, the local squire's grandson. And Arthur also falls in love. But the message in the novel is, do not trust the military men. They will leave any time. After a fight with Adam, Arthur agrees to give up Hetty. Adam sees that Arthur and Hetty are having a relationship, and he fights with Arthur. Arthur leaves Hayslop and returns to the military without telling Hetty, leaving Hetty to Adam. Hetty realizes that Arthur has gone. So she agrees to marry Adam, but then she discovers that she's pregnant with Arthur's child. Hetty is pregnant with Arthur Donnithorne's child. In desperation, she leaves in search of Arthur, but those are before days before email and mobile phones and all that. She's unable to find Arthur. Hetty cannot find Arthur and does not return to the village for fear of shame and ostracism. She is pregnant, visibly pregnant. She cannot return. She is ashamed. And she delivers her baby, and the child is killed when she abandons it in a field. She delivers her baby and she abandons the baby in a field. Some villagers help her, and then she leaves that house. Then she doesn't know what to do with her child. She leaves it in the field and walks away. But then when she feels remorseful and comes back, she finds that the child has died. Hetty is caught with the dead child and sentenced to hang for child murder. At that time, there is a woman, Dina Morris. She is Hetty's cousin and a Methodist preacher. She pledges to stay with Hetty till the end to help her. And Dina's compassion brings about Hetty's confession. So at least even in the eye of God, she is now redeemed. Hetty is redeemed. She confesses. Arthur at this time comes on leave because his grandfather has died, and Arthur comes to attend the funeral. Arthur did not know that Hetty was pregnant. Arthur did not know anything that happened to Hetty. And when he hears of all this, he races to the court and has the sentence commuted to transportation, to exile. He gets the sentence of death changed to exile. Hetty won't be killed now. Adam and Dina, who actually now become aware of their mutual love, marry and live peacefully. The sad thing is, before this, Dina was loved by Adam's brother, Seth. Anyway, the next novel is Silas Marner. So in these novels, early novels of George Eliot, actually Milan the Floss came after Adam Bede. In these early novels, you see very virtuous, rustic people. Their choices sometimes go wrong. They sometimes do wrong things, but they're so good. And they are responsible for their actions. Silas Marner is also a very simple, touching story. The subtitle of the novel is The Weaver of Raveloe, published in 1861, same year as Great Expectations. Silas Marner is living in the village of Raveloe, but he's an outsider there. He's seen as an outsider in Raveloe due to his special skills. He's seen as an outsider. He has come from another place called Lantern Yard. And he has been thrown out. He had been thrown out of Lantern Yard. I mean, he came away from Lantern Yard because he was falsely accused of theft. And his heart is broken because of that. Lantern Yard was a community of religious people. Silas Marner was also religious, but now he has given up religion. He's sad that all this has happened to him. He's given up religion. He refuses to go to church, and he lives in Raveloe. He's a peculiar man. He has special skills. He has come to the village from Lantern Yard. He suffers from epileptic fits, and he can cure people very magically. He has come to Raveloe when he was falsely accused of theft by his religious community at Lantern Yard. In Raveloe, he leads a miserly life. He leads a miserly life. And he hoards money because he was accused of theft. He is making up for it by hoarding money. He makes money with his special skills. Doesn't spend his money. It is saved in the form of gold. In Raveloe, there is a very wealthy man called Squire Cass. He's the wealthiest man in Raveloe. And he has two sons, Godfrey and Dunsey. Godfrey and Dunsey are the sons of Squire Cass. Godfrey is good-natured, and he's secretly married to the opium addict Molly Farren. Without his father knowing, even though he's a very good guy, without his father knowing, he has married one girl, Molly Farren. But outwardly, nobody knows it. He is in love with Nancy Lamita. Not love, he's betrothed to. He's going to be engaged to Nancy Lamita. I should say, about to be engaged to. Not actually love. About to be engaged to. All right. Now, Dunsey is greedy. Dunsey is the other son, Godfrey's younger brother. Dunsey is greedy and cruel and repeatedly blackmails Godfrey with threats to reveal the marriage to their father. Dunsey wants money and Godfrey keeps his father's money. So Dunsey repeatedly blackmails Godfrey to get money, threatening to reveal the secret marriage to their father. Now, Godfrey once gives Dunsey £100 out of their father's money, and Dunsey spends it. He cannot repay it to Godfrey. Instead, Dunsey offers to sell Godfrey's prize horse, but gets the horse also killed in a race. Instead of going straight away to sell the horse, he gets it killed. Dunsey. Godfrey is very upset because what will he tell his father? Dunsey plans to help Godfrey by extorting money from Silas. Finding the cottage empty, he enters the cottage of Silas, takes Silas's money. For Silas, his money is everything. He has been saving money and hoarding it. And if he loses it, it's like death to him because his money is everything for him. Silas is utterly disconsolate to find the money gone. He is shocked and sad to find the money gone. The townsfolk are sympathetic. People are sympathetic to Silas because he's lost his money. And there is one woman, Dolly Winthrop, who urges Silas to go to church, which he has not done after being falsely accused. He has never gone to church after he came there. And Dolly wants Silas to turn to God. Anyway, Dunsey has stolen the money. Nobody knows it. And Dunsey does not return. Godfrey tells his father about the dead horse, but not about his marriage, and somehow gets away with it. Godfrey does not know where Dunsey is. Next, we see the New Year's dance celebration at Squire Cass's household. At Squire Cass's household, New Year Eve celebration is going on. And Godfrey's wife Molly is on the way there because Godfrey's engagement to Molly would be announced at the dance. Molly heard about it. Godfrey's engagement to Nancy Lamita would be announced at the dance. Molly heard about it and she's going there. She has a toddler daughter, Godfrey's toddler daughter, just 1.5 years old daughter. And Molly is going to reveal the secret. Now remember, she's an opium addict. On the way, she takes more opium. She sleeps in the open. It is winter, remember? And she freezes to death. This happens near Silas's house. The little girl wanders away from her mother, enters Silas's house when she sees the door open, and falls asleep in Silas's hearth. People discover that there is a dead woman lying there. Nobody knows who it is because she has come from elsewhere. Godfrey, of course, realizes who it is. Recognizes, but he does not claim his daughter. He does not say it is his daughter. And Silas now likes this girl and adopts her. The girl grows up with Silas. He names her Epi. And Silas has now somebody in his life, something to look forward to. He has become human because of Epi. Epi growing up with him. 16 years pass. Epi is growing up as Silas's daughter. And she is now almost 18 years old. Godfrey, meanwhile, has married Nancy. But look at the strange ways of fate. He did not claim his own daughter. And now Godfrey and Nancy have no children. Squire Cass, the father, has died. And Godfrey is now in possession of the money. He has everything except a child. His own child is growing up at Silas's. Epi has grown into a beautiful woman. And in the stone pit at this time, there is a stone pit near Silas's house. In the stone pit, Dunsey's skeleton is found along with Silas's gold. It becomes clear that Dunsey stole the gold and was making away with it. And he fell into the stone pit and died. Godfrey confides his story to Nancy. Godfrey tells Nancy what happened and that Silas's daughter is actually Godfrey's daughter. But after so many years of marriage, Nancy doesn't really mind and she is eager to adopt Epi. So Godfrey and Nancy go to Silas's house to claim their daughter. But Epi prefers to stay with Silas. Epi says, Silas is my father. And later, she marries Dolly Winthrop's son, Aaron Winthrop. So, Silas gets a wonderful life. And the wrongdoers are punished. Later novels of George Eliot. After a brief visit to Florence, she wrote Romola, set in Florence. Romola by George Eliot is set in 15th century Florence, Renaissance period. It was published serially in the Cornhill magazine. The Cornhill magazine founded by Thackeray himself. Thackeray. And this publication came in 1862-63. Here she deserted native literary landscapes. Until then she was writing about England. Now she writes about Florence in Italy. Next came Felix Holt, The Radical, 1866 publication. Middlemarch, A Study of Provincial Life, was published in independent parts in 1871-72. Not in any periodical, but in independent parts. Please read extra on all these works. Victorian novel is a very important area in all exams. Daniel Deronda. The Impressions of Theophrastus Such. That is her last work. It's actually not a novel. It's a series of essays linked by one narrator. These are the later novels of George Eliot. Those who have Contemporary Encyclopedia of English Literature, please read extra. Extra details there. Others, please do your own research. Felix Holt's. I'll give you a little more, a few more details. Felix Holt is a social novel. I told you her earlier novels. George Eliot's earlier novels were rural novels. Later novels had more social themes. A social novel about political disputes in a small English town at the time of the first Reform Act. That is Felix Holt, The Radical. Middlemarch is set in the fictitious Midlands town of Middlemarch. And it is the story of Dorothea Brooke. It has interlocking narratives. Dorothea's story interlocks with that of Tertius Lydgate. It has underlying social themes such as the status of women, the nature of marriage, idealism and self-interest, religion and hypocrisy, political reform. It's a novel replete with socio-political themes. And it reflects on contemporary issues like the Great Reform Bill, the beginnings of the railways, the death of George IV, the succession of William IV, etc. The protagonist, Dorothea Brooke, is an idealistic, well-to-do young woman engaged in schemes to help the poor. She is like a foil character. Opposite of her character is Tertius Lydgate, married to Rosamund Vincy. George Eliot also wrote some novellas, not really novels, but also novellas, and a surprising amount of poetry. Did you know George Eliot wrote poetry? And it includes The Spanish Gypsy, The Legend of Jubal, and other poems. She was one of the finest letter writers in the language. She also wrote letters. After the death of Lewis, she married in 1880 another man, John Walter Cross. He was many years her junior, and he also eventually became her biographer. She died in December of the same year that she married him. Cross's biography of George Eliot was published in 1885. Now, features of George Eliot's novels. George Eliot was a serious moralist and philosopher in her novels. Morality, right and wrong of people's actions, philosophy, she talked about. Duty is the supreme value of life. You should do your duty. For example, in Silas Marner, Godfrey does not do his duty, which is what is a very important message in the novel. Humble life of rustic people is interesting and exalted. Daily choices have moral significance. There is no escape from reward or punishment due to one's action. The reward or punishment that you will get because of your actions, you can't escape it. And she was associated with philosophers and thinkers like Herbert Spencer, J.S. Mill, and other liberals. Now I'll talk about Lewis Carroll, 1832. He was born in the same year as First Reform Act. And Walter Scott died in this year. He died in 1898. Lewis Carroll was Charles Dodson, who lived in Oxford. Oxford is an important presence in his novels and writings. He was interested in performing magic tricks and writing poetry. When I was walking along some road in Oxford, somewhere in Oxford, beside Oxford University, there is a countryside. There's a lot of forest area associated, wild area near Oxford University. And I saw a huge rabbit hole. I wouldn't have fallen down it because it was not that huge. I could have slipped into it. My foot might have got stuck in it though. And then I thought, oh God, Lewis Carroll wrote Alice in Wonderland because of the actual rabbit holes that he saw there. He became a mathematician, logician, teacher, and an ordained deacon, that is, clergyman. He was plagued by a chronically weak chest. I think George Orwell also had chest problems. And he had a stammer that he acquired in early childhood. He began to pursue photography, often choosing children as the subject. And one of his favorite models was a young girl named Alice Little, who later became the basis for the fictional character Alice in Alice in Wonderland. His first publication under the name Lewis Carroll was a poem called Solitude. It was published in the periodical, the Train periodical, a book, I don't know. His most famous works are Alice's Adventures in Wonderland and Through the Looking Glass, that is the sequel. And he produced a dozen mathematical writings also. His friends included John Ruskin, a Victorian prose writer, John Ruskin, D.G. Rossetti, William Holman Hunt, John Everett Millais, Arthur Hughes and a fairy tale author named George MacDonald. Let's talk about Alice's Adventures in Wonderland, 1865. As everybody might know, it's a story of a girl called Alice who falls down a rabbit hole into a fantasy world populated by peculiar anthropomorphic creatures. Please, for God's sake, look it up, because occasionally they have asked about Alice in Wonderland as well. The story begins outdoors on May 4th. And that was the birthday of Alice Little. And Through the Looking Glass begins on November 4th, which is the half birthday, I think. Or is it vice versa? One of these is the birthday, the other is the half birthday. Alice's Adventures in Wonderland uses frequent changes in size as a plot device. Frequent changes in size is a plot device. He draws on the imagery of playing cards here. There are parallels in Through the Looking Glass. Everything here is paralleled there, mirrored there. I will talk to you about it later. The tale plays with logic. Through the Looking Glass and What Alice Found There came in 1871. It has the poems Jabberwocky and Walrus and the Carpenter. They have asked in National Eligibility Test, Jabberwocky is written, it's a poem by whom? Which writer? As you know, it's a sequel to Alice's Adventures in Wonderland. It's a kind of mirror image to Wonderland. The story opens indoors while Alice in Wonderland story opens outdoors. On November 4th, it is the day before Guy Fawkes Day. And uses frequent changes in time while the other was size. In Alice in Wonderland, it was size. Here, time and space. It draws on the imagery of chess, while in Alice in Wonderland, it was playing cards. There are many mirror themes, including opposites, time running backwards, etc. here. Other works are What the Tortoise Said to Achilles. The story of Tortoise and Achilles has been said, it is one of Zeno's paradoxes. You can look up in the internet what that is. Zeno's paradox. A Tangled Tale. All based on legends and fairy tales. Three Sunsets and Other Poems. The Hunting of the Snark. Sylvie and Bruno. Thomas Hardy will be another video. So we have come to the end of the video on Victorian novelists, except Thomas Hardy and Charles Dickens. Thank you.